cash back, real tips for saving more of your hard-earned money. Today, we've got simple ways to get your finances back on track for the new year, including new ways of thinking about your money that may surprise you.
NBC 10 at Issue starts now.
Good morning to you. I'm Erin Coleman for NBC 10 at Issue. We begin with your money and how to keep more of it in your wallet this new year. Simple tips for a financial rescue plan that can help really just about anyone. Joining me is Jamie Hopkins. Hopkins is an associate professor at the American College of Financial Services in Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania. He teaches estate and retirement planning. Jamie, thanks for being here with us.
Erin, thanks for having me on.
All right, let's jump right in. We've got a couple of tips, and your first financial rescue tip has to do with holiday gift cash. Let's say you were lucky enough to get $100 from grandma this year. What do you do with that money?
Yeah, the first thing I tell people to do, especially around the holidays, is pay off that credit card, right? That you probably spend some money on it, right, buying other people some holiday gifts. So if you get $100 back, make sure you put that towards things that have the highest interest kind of tied to them, which is almost always your credit card debt.
A lot of people may have overspent this holiday season, and when you see that number, it's a big number. Is $100 really going to make that big of a difference?
Yeah, so $100 or $150, it all makes a big difference with the credit card, because if you have an interest rate at 20-25%, you know, that's a substantial debt that's growing if you're letting that balance sit. So I know a lot of people want to say, well, that's why I use my credit card, yeah, so I didn't have to pay it today. But if you think about it, right, did you want to pay 25% more on all the purchases that you made this season? Probably not, right? So even if you can put $100 against it, it's saving that interest moving forward. It's one of the best places to put it. Now, you can also look at other places to put it, into some savings or into the stock market, into an IRA, but that credit card debt's typically the first one that you should tackle.
And if it's a big number, don't get discouraged. Just keep at it. Keep chipping away at the number.
Yeah. And so one of the things about that is some people actually start with the smallest account balances
first. I've
heard
that, yeah.
And that actually comes from a behavioral aspect of finance, and that's actually a bad behavioral thing. So people tend to see a $25 account and a $50 account, and that actually feels worse than one $75 account. So people typically take on the $25 account first. But what you should do is always search for the highest interest rate one first. And it's hard to overcome that because we have that aversion to multiple debt accounts.
Yeah. All right. So what if you can't make a payment one month? What should you do?
Yeah. So if you can't make, you know, some payment, whether it's credit card, house, other debt, you really got to prioritize your payments. And that's what you need to do. You need to think about, what things do I need to be able to pay this month? So, you know, utilities, you don't want your heat, water shut off.
Yeah.
You don't want your mortgage to not be paid. So those are things you should really deal with first. And I say those are our necessities. Then you can move to things that have collateral attached to it. So maybe your car, because you also don't want somebody to come and repossess,
yeah,
your car. Now, the third one there that you might not be able to meet, maybe you have a doctor's payment or a credit card. Those could actually be in a third bucket. So I would deal with the other two first, and then you get to those, because they're not going to come collect this month. And you can often call a doctor's office, hospital, or even your credit card company to negotiate a payment plan or even a lower payment.
To have them work with you. Okay, the next tip, you say, when it comes to building your budget, don't do mental accounting. What does that mean, and what should we do?
Yeah, so mental accounting, again, another behavioral finance term. And what that is we think about money that different piles of money are for different things. That you might have a jar that says, you know, this is for emergencies, this is for our vacation, and you're putting money in there every month. And then you think, well, we also have a credit card debt over here.
Mm-hmm.
And those are different things. We pay our credit card debt with our income each month. Well, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Money's fungible. And what that means is it's really all the same. You shouldn't have a jar sitting there with money in it that's getting no interest or growth on it while you have credit card debt over here. So what that means is you have to think about all of your money as the same. And people like to put money into different buckets for different reasons, but that really financially doesn't make any sense. But that's kind of where mental accounting, we need to overcome that hurdle.
So is it also about putting pen to paper? I mean, actually physically write it down so you can see it?
Yeah, so you actually do need to write things down. That helps you visualize and follow through. So we know that from athletes all the way through. So I actually grew up swimming with Michael Phelps, and he actually wrote down when he was a kid that he wanted to be in the Olympics, and he used to look in the mirror and think about himself receiving a gold medal. Now, that that still applies to budgeting and everything else we want to accomplish in life. So put the goals down, visualize them, and you're more likely to follow through.
There you go. All right, let's talk about medical bills. You touched on this a minute ago, but your advice is to call and negotiate a lower fee. How do you do that? And does it really work, especially with medical bills?
Yeah, so medical bills is one where hospitals, they usually have finance departments, which will help you with payment plans or interest rates if you can't pay it. And they'll come up with, and they'll work with you. So that's a little bit different than some of your other debts. But medical bills is definitely one where you can negotiate. Now, you might hear advice, you can also renegotiate credit card debt. That's really hard. I don't know a lot of people who have successfully done that. Will it occur? Yes, but it's going to take a lot of work. It's a lot of phone calls, a lot of people telling you, no, we're not going to let you do that. But with hospital bills, medical bills, sometimes if you can make a lump sum payment, they'll actually drop it down or allow you to pay over a number of months without interest accruing. So those are good conversations to have if money gets a little tight around the holiday season.
Negotiate. All right, good tip. What about prepaying your mortgage? Some people add a little extra to their monthly payments to pay the loan off faster. Is that a good use of the extra cash?
Yeah, so this is one area that I'm really strict on. You should not be prepaying your mortgage. With mortgage rates at, you know, under 4% or 4.25%, it's not a good use of money. That's actually a really low interest rate, and they're really designed for long periods of payments, and you should stick to that payment. Prepaying it is really giving up opportunity to use that money better elsewhere, whether it's paying off credit card debt or whether it's just investing it, putting it away for retirement. If you're getting 8% returns in your investments, why put it at something that's only 4%, your mortgage? So that really, from a financial standpoint, financial planning standpoint, doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It's not a great strategy, but people feel comfortable doing that.
Yeah. So resist if you can.
Yeah, resist that. I know you want to feel like you're paying off the house faster, but it's not a great financial decision.
All right. You also say most workers make one big mistake when it comes to fixing their finances, and that involves raises.
Yeah. So a lot of people are very hesitant about asking for it, right? We see that through data. I actually see a lot of women tend to be a little bit more hesitant from some research to ask for raises. So, but there's a strategy about that. It's not just you wake up one day, you rush into your boss's office and say, I need more money today. And that word's actually a bad one, the need. You don't want to have that conversation that you need something. You want to frame it in, you know, I've done a good job this year. I'm looking towards the future. What are my goals? And this is the value that I bring to this place. And that could be anywhere you work. And with low unemployment today, you know, wages rising, a little bit more negotiable power there from the worker to actually bring this conversation up. The other thing is, don't compare yourself to other workers and say that they got a raise or they make this much. That sets it in kind of a bad tone. So you want to be very positive and proactive
about what you've done.
Yes, about what you've done. And so that just, that puts it in a good light, and you allow your boss to come to the realization that you're adding value there.
And get the courage up to do that. All right, here are some more money saving tips from the website The Simple Dollar. Sell your unwanted items. Recent research finds an average yard sale nets more than $100. Sign up for every free customer rewards program that you can. That includes gas discounts from the supermarket. Remove your credit card numbers from your online accounts. That's a biggie. Shoppers with stored numbers are more likely to hit the buy button. And finally, make a visual reminder of your debt. Write down how much you owe and keep it where you can see it. Update it as you pay it down. And a final tip, automate your savings and your bills. Use your bank to make automatic payments to your savings account and your credit. Late payments can wreck your credit score and your savings. In 2015, credit card companies collected more than $11 billion in penalty fees. That's huge. $11
billion. Huge.
All right, some good tips there. Some great tips from you, Jamie Hopkins, from the American College of Financial Services. Thanks for that.
Yep. Thank you, Aaron.
Appreciate your time. All right, next on NBC 10.